do this correctly. Welcome everyone to our Monday night Upper Midwest Bead Society. Jan, do you have announcements for us?
Yeah, so June and July is our new member drive. So it's kind of a slow month for us. So we're trying to drum up new members by having a drawing among those new members for the Toho mini kit, the 2023 version. So it would be great if you know someone who needs to be a member because they like beading, get them to join by the end of the month. That would be great. The other thing was, we're still looking for a local site to have periodically have a meeting, a local meeting that we would still Zoom. So if anybody, wants to step up and help with that, that would be great. And that's all I've got, Rochelle.
Okay, then we have Marlene's going to make a state fair announcement, right?
Right. We still need volunteers to demonstrate at the fair on August 30th. We still need people you only have to do a 2-hour stint, and then you have the rest of the day to spend at the fair. You get a free ticket to come in. Right now, the admission for an adult is $18, and for a senior, it's $16. So if you get a free ticket, that'll save you some money. We need people to work from 11 to 1 and 3 to 5 and maybe 5 to 7. So
a couple members in here earlier in the week, and they said they had time to do it. And one of them was Svetlana Sepagina. And so I told her to contact you. So I gave her your email.
Okay. Maggie, I think, tried to contact me and she said the email was wrong. Morris the Cat 22. Has to have 22 in there. Someone's already got it.
Okay. So let me see if I gave her the correct email. So I bet. Yeah, I gave her the correct one. So
Morris the Cat 22 at comcast.net.
Yep. So I will. Yeah, so
Svetlana. She typed it wrong. I don't know, but she messaged me on my phone. So
okay.
I talked to her.
Okay. Any other announcements?
I have an announcement.
Alrighty, Lisa.
Okay. I don't know if anybody's opened up their email lately, but Interweave came out with their Reader's Choice Award winners. And some of the categories, let's see, best jewelry making trends was Goody Beads, and our very own honorable mention went to Maggie T Designs. So congratulations, Maggie. Yay.
Thanks for saying that, Lisa. I hated to toot my own horn, so I left it alone.
I'll toot it for you. Woohoo! best new products of 2023 was Tierra Cast, and they also won best charms and pendants, so good for them. Best ethically sourced gemstones was Dakota Stones.
Oh yeah. So
yay, congratulations to Dakota Stones. And best recycled bead and jewelry supplies is our very own Toho Beads. So yeah. Yay, Toho. So yeah, congratulations everybody.
That's well super. Done.
Thanks for saying something, Lisa.
Oh, you're welcome. Well deserved.
Yes. So, all right, Becky.
Okay, we are still looking for a board member to take over the position of dealing with the retreats. And we do have the case at the state fair. Marlene, do you want to talk about that?
She already did. No?
No, the case.
Oh, the case, yeah.
The display case, yes. I only have 3 people that say they're going to, I have one piece myself. I have one No, I have two, sorry. And then Maggie said she's got a piece that she'll drop off at Bobby Bead. So if you have a piece that you want to be in the display case that won't be judged, get it to, you can get it to contact me, or you can leave it at Bobby Bead with Rochelle, and then I will collect them before the fair and take them over there.
Yeah, I've been telling several people, and so Hannah's going to have one. I know that Svetlana said she was going to have one.
Okay.
And, I was going to put in my sunflower. So I have, what's the deadline for you, for them, that you're going to pick it up?
Well, I'm going to, I just emailed Samantha to ask her what day we would be allowed in there to put the stuff in the display case. And so I will probably put it like 2 or 3 days before that date, so I have time to come down to Bobby Bead and collect them and then get them over there.
Sounds perfect.
So I will let you know when I find out. I'm thinking they'll probably let us in there on one of the entry days.
Sounds good. All right, Doris.
We can post and send out that date too as soon as we have it available.
Sounds good.
Yes. Cool. Usually we just pick a date and tell them when we're coming, but it's almost always during the entry days.
Okay.
Or after, well, while they're judging, either way. We don't usually wait for them to tell us when we can come. We just say we want to come this day and ask if that's okay. And they have never said no.
Oh, okay.
Well, although the person that used to take care of it is no longer there. So this is a whole different set of people. So they may change their mind, but that's how it was done in the past.
I'll wait for her email to come back then.
Okay. I would like to announce that I've had several people bugging me to have bring out my estate stuff again. So I'm having a sale at my house tomorrow and Wednesday, if anybody would like to come, starting at 9 till whatever, and I'm serving lunch. I can stick my address in the chat if anybody's interested. And I'm willing to be the board member to do the retreats.
Yay.
Because Roberta is retiring from that position at the end of the year. Is that correct?
Yes.
She's fulfilling this whole year. Okay. Super. And anybody else? Well, these are then what we're showing for our, Let's Be Live. This is my, it's Beating Inside the Hoop. And so it is a descending brick stitch. And then you highlight your focal feature. So a 40 millimeter hoop is the size hoop you need, and size 8-0 beads, mostly 5 grams is all you need. And like 1 gram of 11s, there's like 12 11s in there. So that is on the 22nd of July from 1 to 3 o'clock. Our Beading in the Garden fell through. Chris got a giant grant and is working full time, so we just can't go down to the garden and bead right now. So this is my class that I'm teaching at Bead Fest in Pennsylvania. So this is a wonderful practice for me. And also because we just got all these wonderful hoops in at Bobby Bead, and the new recycled beads are what's in these. And I'll have kits and recycled beads starting at after the show in Pennsylvania at the end of the month, if anybody wants. But otherwise, we have supplies at Bobby Bead. You just, like I said, need 5 grams of 8-0s, 1 gram of 11s, one focal bead in the center, and 40 millimeter hoops. So it's going to be lots of fun from 1 to 3 on the 22nd.
And just on another note on the Bead Fest at Lancaster, Rochelle and I are both going to be teaching a couple of make and take classes. Hers is going to be that light wheel hoop earring. And then I've got two. One is a boho box weave bookmark, and the other one is the triple R bracelet number 2 using the Toho rebeads and the beetle on recycled cord. So it's an almost entirely recycled product bracelet. And Rochelle and Toho are going to be doing a live Facebook event, and we'll be putting our make and takes on Facebook as much as we can, but Rochelle will be doing a Facebook live event with Team Toho that'll go worldwide on a ready, set, go bead stringing contest in our booth.
Yep. How fast can you string on 50 beads onto a needle? And so you have to use the needle to pick them up too. You can't use your hand. So it's a really lot of fun. They did it at the hobby show in Japan and had a lot of fun. So Toho was encouraging us to do it too. So they're giving away first, second, and third prizes as well. So if you're going to Bead Fest in Lancaster, there's all sorts of fun at Maggie T and Team Toho booth. We're right across from the stage, so you can't miss us. And
it's a long haul to get there. So if you can't get there, catch us on Facebook.
Facebook as well, and just encourage. Otherwise, we also will have a live Peace Ring show. The Peace Ring has been around now for 7 years. And so the Japan television, since they invited Toho to the G7 summit, has now invited Toho to participate in their Peace Day live from the memorial, the Peace Memorial, where you can see the atomic bomb destruction, everything from there, what's left of their memorial. But it's going to be live on Facebook and Japanese television. And so it's really exciting. And so that's August 8th at 7 p.m. if anybody wants to join us on Facebook so that you can watch and see the celebration from Japan live from the memorial. And so Toho will be out there live. But it's super exciting and fun. There's so much going on that we really want to invite you all to be part of it. But now we have our wonderful special event of how to, you've got your spotlight. And then let's see here, we'll add a spotlight. And so we've got Pam Smith here from Phoenix Fire Jewelry. She is an amazing copper torch artist. As you can see, my beautiful necklace is flame colored copper. Sorry, I'm a little crooked, wrong way. There you go. I'm backwards in my mirror. But she does everything under the sun. She has booths at the Renaissance Fair. She does booths. She just came back from Balloon Fest in Wisconsin. How to have an alternative lifestyle. If you don't want to have a brick and mortar shop, if you want to have more fun with your selling your wares than just a normal website, Pam has been doing it this way for how long now, Pam?
Over 30 years I've been at the Renaissance Fair.
Oh my gosh, there is just so much fun that you can do to have a business instead of just your, you know, average store, brick and mortar. And or so we are going to show you here, blah, blah, blah. Hopefully it all is coming through. And so Phoenix Fire Jewelry by Pam Smith. Fairy tale fantasy with gothic undertones and a bohemian spirit. I just love how you describe yourself.
You know, that was some lady that written that in some article. So then I was like, oh, cool.
That's really cool. Well, I mean, it's perfect for your, you know. And so why don't you introduce yourself a little bit? Tell us about yourself, how you got started in this crazy industry.
Okay. Hi, I'm Pam. And I have never done this little painting before, so I'm sorry if I'm not doing it right, but I'll try. I I've always just liked to travel and to make my own thing. So I started making jewelry and selling. I think Cedar Fest was my very first festival.
Oh, wow, really?
Back when Cedar Fest was a thing.
Yeah, that was a long time ago.
$100 with leather bracelets. So I was so excited. So does that answer the question?
Well, it is partly. I mean, how did you decide you wanted to do festivals and do that kind of thing instead of like putting your jewelry line in stores or selling as a, you know, collection to Macy's or something like that?
Oh, I guess I wouldn't have been against Macy's, you know, wanting to purchase my collection, but I'm not that organized, I guess. So I don't know, I started, you know, like little festivals like that. I guess I'm just a carny at heart.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, before I started making stuff on my own.
What did you do in the carnival? Can I ask?
The games.
Oh, okay.
The games you can actually win,
not the fake kind. Okay.
But I know how those work. So anyway, I guess I just like to travel. So I mostly traveled and did the flea markets. And then when I was pregnant with my son, I got into the Renaissance Festival in Minnesota. And that was in 91. I built a little tent. And that's not this shop, because I bought that from the actually Bobby Bead. And what did he say it was?
He said it was
96. So at 96, I bought the shop, but I was at the fair in 91.
And
with my little baby. But I don't have any of those pictures, because those are all, you know, paper.
Right before we had such fancy phones and such neat.
They're buried in the box. So I started with leather jewelry and stuff. And then I taught myself how to do the copper. And then that was really popular. So then it kind of became the thing. You know, I've tried other things, silver and lots of different variety of items. Jewelry and accessory related, but people really like the flame colored copper.
Well, it's really unique. I mean, because you're actually creating all the beautiful patterns and colors, and each one is a unique little piece of art.
It is. It's endlessly entertaining.
And so this is a picture of your shop at the Renaissance Fair in Minnesota, right?
Yeah, I think that was maybe last year, whenever we did that shape, that U-shaped shape. Rochelle helps me out there sometimes on her days off.
On Saturdays when I can get out of Bobby Bead. Yeah. It's a lot more fun to work at Renaissance Fair than Bobby Bead some days, because you get to dress up and actually go and, you know, enjoy the fair from the booth perspective. There's another picture of the booth. Let's click. There you go. This is another shop picture of the booth. This is, I think, how it was originally more set up on the side.
Yeah, this is some other year.
And then there's a front little part. And so re-merchandising, and then you've got all kinds of earrings. And tell us about your perspective with all your customers. You have a really incredible rapport with your customers while you're at the fairs. And
you think so?
I think so. Well, they love you. I had a customer in the shop here today. He saw my necklace and he's like, "Oh my God, I think I have one of those." And I said, "Yeah, it's from the Res." And he said, "I was there last year."
Oh, okay.
And so
you try to be fun, you know, it's fun to play with people. That's why I like Renaissance fairs too. The flea markets I do in the summer in Wisconsin are like that also.
Which flea markets are you doing over there?
Up north, they have a St. Germain flea market is on Mondays. And one of the potters at the Renaissance Festival told me about this market. So he's like, "Well, if you're in, I'm in Wisconsin, go on Monday, go to St. Germain." So I went and checked it out. People go there every year, you know, the same people. It's kind of like the Renaissance mm-hmm. Festival. It's the thing they do when they go to Wisconsin on vacation. They go to that flea market.
And it happens every Monday throughout the summer?
Yep.
Wow, that's really cool.
The cool thing about flea markets is this, I don't know how many of you apply for shows and do like shows, but it's really hard to get in with jewelry to almost any art fair show that's like a really nice art fair. At least I haven't had a lot of success with that. So I just got tired of this application and paying $30 for every application and then not getting in. So, you know, so I started doing other events that were easier to get in, not as fancy pantsy, not as expensive.
And how do you hear about all these other different flea markets and festivals, street fairs, through word of mouth?
Mostly word of mouth. That's the best source, is asking other vendors, because, or artists, you know, because they're the ones who know people putting on the shows may or may not know how successful their show is, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then, you know, just events happening. You know, you can go to a small town festival. It really depends, though. I mean, if you're doing like super fine beadwork stuff, people are going to have their minds blown by that with you.
Right.
And have the bread and butter stuff.
Right. And so, because your average market is only one day or 2 days long that you're doing, and so you have to set everything up and then break it all down each night, or you can leave it out.
Art fairs, you know, you can go and set up your tent and usually leave, take your jewelry with or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Flea markets, you go, you drive into your spot, you open the back, you just set up your table, and it's not that fancy, but there's probably a picture somewhere.
There is. Let's, well, we'll continue to click, and then you can, this looks like.
That's a flea market setup right there.
Because this one is your van, and you pull it up the back. And so this is one of the Wisconsin flea markets.
Yeah. So.
And so is this one of your carts from earlier?
That is my cart at the Ohio Renaissance Festival now. Part of the gazebo there now,
which is, there we go, is this the cart?
That is the first year I did that, when Ryan, my son, was working in Ohio, so I wanted to go visit him. So his boss said, well, she can use a beer cart.
So, well, I love how you turned a beer cart into something that's very romantically artistic. I mean, look at that.
Yeah, it's pretty fancy. Right, and actually took that picture.
So. It's a great photo. And so then, so this was the original cart, and then this is what it's evolved into.
Yeah, then, and then that's like the second year I was there. So the cart's in a different location, but it was the same beer cart.
Okay.
So I came back and I had a different display. I put they were screens, window screens, that the earrings are on. So I got those leaning up against each other.
I was gonna say, because you have to have really unique ways to display stuff when you're kind of
everything.
Right.
Wind and rain and sun and all the stuff. The other picture is my grandniece Denisha selling at our gazebo at the Ohio Renaissance Fair. So we've painted it now. We did some construction on it. So that was last year at the fair.
I think I have construction photos.
Yeah. That's the part. And so that's the cart on the left. And the gazebo, Tamara was fixing the roof. Because they gave us the gazebo.
Oh, that's really nice. And so, but you have to, you buy your spots at the Renaissance Fair, like, right?
My son Ryden, who's actually in this picture, the picture of him and the guy up on the roof there, his friend Jesse, that is from Texas.
Okay.
I was putting a copper roof on a little gazebo that I had in Texas at the Sherwood Forest Fair. And then the picture on the right is my grandniece and my niece, Tamara, who works with me pretty extensively now. She keeps my paperwork in order, because that's probably the most important thing.
being an artist seems a lot more easier than like all the business side of it. Yeah. And then you have the renovation side. You've got like, you've got to do it all.
Yeah. So I didn't do so good with my taxes, but I'm all caught up now. So I don't recommend getting behind on your taxes.
And so when you're doing all these different blues in different states, do you have to apply for a different tax in each state or reseller's license or? Yeah,
either a permanent, like I have a permanent retail sales tax license, I guess.
Okay.
Ohio, Wisconsin, Minnesota. And the other ones I apply for like a temporary thing.
Okay.
It's just, you know, if you're just going to Iowa once.
Oh, okay.
Be like, I'm just doing this one show here.
So then you wouldn't have to have a permanent one. Do they cost in all these other states, or it's just like Minnesota? Because Minnesota's are free.
I think it's free. Maybe a little bit.
And so, because I would think that would be hard, but each state you have to manage differently. And so, yeah, this is more than at Sherwood Forest.
Yeah, that's at Sherwood Forest. So then I was putting a copper roof onto my gazebo. So then
I think I mixed them up. And so that's Ohio.
Jumble of stuff.
I was trying to put them together here.
You did great with no direction. I just was like, here's a bunch of pictures. Bye.
Well, I mean, you were busy. You were at two different art fairs or flea markets last week in Wisconsin, right?
Yeah, I did the St. Germain and Boulder Junction. Then I came back here and made some stuff. And then I went back for the Hot Air Balloon Festival, which was really cool.
Wow.
And we made hot air balloon stuff, which was really popular. So, but that picture of the metal roof, that was just...
This one.
You know, like if I could do, yeah, that's
because that looks beautiful.
I bought the rolls of copper, cut out the strips of, you know, the little things, and then was hammering them and stuff. And then I was like, you know, you guys are stronger than me, so here, why don't you?
So did you torch them as well first?
Then I did some coloring on there too. So on
because it looks like magical dragon scales here.
Yeah,
and so
they were.
Wow! So you're gonna do that to the Minnesota Fair booth too?
God no. It was just a little gazebo. I would maybe do it to a cart.
Or maybe the little part that just sticks out of the Minnesota, I don't know what you call it.
When they figure out what they're doing with their property, then I'll invest money in the booth.
Right.
So
is this Ohio then?
No, this is at
Sherwood Forest.
This is right. It's a reintroduction into the Renaissance Fair. That's my son. Who was on the road with me for a little while, and then he was working in Ohio, and then he died in 2021. So it's good to see these memories. He was a sweetheart, but so that's us dressed up down there.
I love it.
Yeah,
it's so cool. And so it's the Excelsior Kris Kringle Market.
Yeah.
It was what I took it off of Facebook.
Okay.
And so that's how you had marked it. And so I've never heard of that market.
Kris Kringle Market. It's an Excelsior. It's like a German Christmas market they do there. So it's outside Thanksgiving weekend, basically.
Okay.
Black Friday weekend.
Oh, okay. So now you stopped doing that since you were doing the winter market last year and switched over. The
European Christmas market in St. Paul.
And so
that was a fun show.
I mean, it looks really like a fun tent. And so you were more at night because at the European market.
It's daytime and nighttime in Excelsior.
Is that fair still going on?
I believe so. They moved it to the Commons, which is it was in a parking lot behind a brewery. So it's really good combination of events and people. They had a warm place to go and, you know, drink. And then they have the glue vine. The hot spiced wine is really good at the, you know, while you're selling stuff in the cold.
Yeah, and so because you've done a variety of them, you were at the Minnesota or the Minneapolis Farmer Market Annex. How long ago was that you were doing that?
On and off, I've been at the Annex for, I don't know, maybe 15 years.
Yeah,
long time.
And so how do you like with the Minneapolis Farmer Market versus, like, it seems like
the Annex, it's kind of flea markety, you know.
Yeah, there's more artisans there all the time, it seems like.
It's kind of a mixture. It's okay. I don't do it often anymore because I'm too lazy. I don't want to get up at 5:30 in the morning. And it was okay, but it wasn't. I have Etsy now. Etsy has been a lifesaver,
right?
For, like, now I don't necessarily have to do all these.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't have to go do that. I can just do Etsy if I wanted to.
And not,
and my niece has been doing shows for me, so I don't always have to go do the show.
Oh, either. That's good. Well, here's one. This was a virtual makers collective. What was that, just an online show?
That was during the pandemic. Yeah. Oh, when we were trying those things.
Did it work out at all for you?
No, I spent a lot of time putting together the little things, and then it did not go well for me. I think some people did it good,
mm-hmm.
but for whatever reason, I was, you know, so I did not do that.
And so it's because that's the question everybody keeps asking in the store here when they come in, you know, is how do I get my work out there to people, and where's the best places to sell, who does this and that. And so what's the festival here on the left, the market? This one looks
okay. That's in New Orleans, and I was down there. Actually, I had gone to Ohio to do a wholesale show. And then there was this giant ice storm. So we didn't make any money, and we could go home with no money, or we could go somewhere else. So we went to do a show in New Orleans at the convention center. And it wasn't that awesome. It was a Helen Brett show. I don't know if any of you have heard of her name, but it was like, they're pretty big. They used to be pretty big deal shows. Now they're kind of junky.
Mm.
So it wasn't that great, and we were still in New Orleans, and there was this market on Decatur Street, which is not there anymore, but it was called Second Line Market, and they had antiques and stuff, and they have night markets. They would have like an afternoon. It started at like 1, and you could do the 1 to 5 shift or something, or you could be there from 6 to midnight. So I just started doing that and ended up doing a lot. I stayed there for 3 months.
Oh my gosh.
So
wow.
New Orleans is fabulous. If you ever want to go see a lot of cool art, I saw some really cool bead art down there too.
Absolutely. And so is that something you could just say, oh yeah, I want to stay another week. Oh yeah, I'll stay another week. You didn't have to like prearrange, you know, like and sign contracts and everything like that for these?
No, this was kind of just through the store. They had a lady who was managing it. This is before the pandemic. So there were cruise ships coming in there, and you know, you could check the schedule to see what ships were coming in or which conventions were in town. Sometimes if you call a convention center and see what's on their roster, you can sign up for random things, you know, because they need vendors at a lot of different types of things, especially if you're making jewelry that is, you know, fits something, whatever it might be, you know. Car jewelry or whatever, I don't know.
And so I'm not sure which one this was.
That is in Colorado at a festival I did. It was an indoor Renaissance festival.
Oh wow.
Yeah, Ryden was going to be there and working for the games, so he told me about it, so I went to join him there in Colorado indoors.
I didn't know you could have an indoor festival like that, but I suppose if it's a big enough.
They did the jousting in the arena.
Right. Yeah.
They had vendors and a couple stages and beer, you know.
Right.
So it ended up being okay.
All right.
You know,
for what it was. It wasn't great for everybody, but it, again, you know, you guys probably know the jewelry is always, they might not be buying anything else, but they're buying jewelry.
Well, that's the thing. Everybody needs gifts for people.
Yeah.
And so, because yeah, it looks like you've got, you know, a lot of different setups. I know I've worked with you in different setups, but everybody seems so excited in these festival environments.
Yeah.
And it's not just walking into a normal store. You know, it's always,
yeah,
there's more to it. And
I've done my share of malls, and they're really, you know, it can be fun. Like, you can get into it with people, especially right before Christmas.
Okay.
People get excited, and you know, but they're like long grinding hours where you're just sitting there and people don't care that you're sitting there. And you know, whereas you go to a festival and you're, it's just way more fun.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so like that picture, that's a Christmas show, but that one is at Utapil's Brewery over here. They have the what does she call it, the oh my gosh, I'm so sorry, I'm not coming up with the name, but she does it's a festival they had there.
Okay. And it's during the winter time, or right before Christmas?
It was on my Facebook thing. I know.
Right, yeah. And so, yeah, I took these pictures off of your Facebook.
Yeah,
there.
Anya, but I can't think of the name of the event. Silly me. Anyways, it was like a European market thing.
Uh-huh.
That's how I ended up at the European market, because she got a booth there.
Oh, okay.
And then we all did it collectively. And it was so good. I was like, wow, if I made that much just being like in 1/10 of the booth space,
mm-hmm,
I should have my own space there.
And so the one on the right here, this looks like another.
That's back in New Orleans.
Back in New Orleans. Okay. Yeah. I mean, it's just, I love New Orleans. The atmosphere is so cool there.
Yeah, it is a blast there. I love people on vacation. I would rather go sell anywhere where there's a vacationers, you know, Grand Marais. I like to go for Grand Marais.
And so what's the festival in Grand Marais that you do that is?
Well, they have a really nice art fair in July, which I've done, but I think they've switched to the stupid jury process.
Oh, right. Uh-huh. So it's more formal and everything.
So now, I know a lot of people don't get in. But I've always done Fisherman's Picnic up there, which is just like a town festival. So once you're in, you're basically in, you just go, give them your money and they don't care. You might be set up next to some junky thing, but I don't care. It just makes you look better, really.
Right.
You know, to a certain degree, if you're,
yeah,
you know, got museum quality pieces.
Well, right. Well, you always decorate your booths all up pretty. You create ambiance in your booth and everything. And so, as you can see here, all the people shopping, I mean, this is their real reaction. They really are having fun, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, granted, the spiced wine and everything does help a little bit.
Yeah, that's back at it. That's a different year at Chris and Kendall Market.
And I know we were two doors down at the winter European market at the depot from the spice wine tent. So everybody that came by us was fully lubricated.
Yeah, drinking and shopping is always a good combination.
It is. And so this looks like a whole nother different types of booth setups. And
yeah,
I'm not exactly sure, but how do you come up with a setup?
That might be the back end. Oh no, there's a tent there. I'm not sure where that is. Maybe some art fair somewhere.
And
oh, I think it's Bayfield. I think I was in Bayfield.
And so it's really, I mean, it's interesting, no matter what the size or shape of your booth, you do still have though a signature look, you know, having all your things on the black. And
yeah, that came along a little later. I used to use carpet squares, but then this is about this time frame, I guess, probably when most when I started being online and when I started, you know, it was probably about the time when I got the black velvet things. And but before that, I was just using these like carpet squares and I lay stuff on them. And I've tried a million different things. They were good because they didn't blow away. And
oh, right.
Stuff was on there and you could arrange them really pretty if you wanted to. So, and then the Patriot Mark, that's at the VA hospital in Minneapolis, I believe. Yeah.
I didn't know they had little art shows or
favorites. They have a vendor thing. Well, you can hook up with the VA hospital.
Oh, and just have it there all the time?
Well, or sign up for a certain time frame, okay, and then you pay like a percentage, and it was okay. I did it a few times. Uh-huh. It was when I was taking care of my mom. So my mom was actually there with me. She had dementia, but so she couldn't be alone. So she would come to shows, mm-hmm, with me. And that's when I really just like went deep into the flea markets and things where you don't have to be, you know. It's like half a day, you know, and your mom can sit in the car or she doesn't want to get out, or she can talk to the old guy next door. Or, you know, she had fun at the VA hospital too, you know, because right, it was just all the people there. I don't know. So
it sounds like great. Well, you really, like I said, one unique thing that I've always noticed is that you take pictures of your customers wearing your jewelry.
Yeah.
I mean, most people, I don't see that around.
It's marketing, but it is a lot of fun. I really enjoy taking pictures and I really like looking at the pictures later. It just makes me so happy. But it's Tong, my complicated partner, was studying marketing and he, uh-huh, told me, you need social proof. So these are social proof pictures.
They are.
You know, people see that and they're like, wow, right, I could wear that. You know, it's just like, you know.
Exactly. I mean, and you make jewelry for everyone, for every occasion. It goes with t-shirts, jeans, tank tops, you know, or your dog collars, you know. I mean, it doesn't just have to go with a corset, that's for sure.
Yeah.
You know, and but people are very happy to show it off. And then on your social media, you tag them and everything and put in their the event it was in. So I think that's, yes, a really special thing to bring it home to people. You know, and look at how well they wear it too.
Yeah, aren't they beautiful? I mean, look how gorgeous these girls are. They're just so sweet.
Yeah.
Now they're both from the Minneapolis Farmers Market on different days.
Yeah. And, you know, and by looking at your booth, you couldn't tell where you were, but you can tell it's you, you know, I mean, you have a signature look. So I think that's one really interesting part of how to market. This must be, yep, New Orleans Market.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's New Orleans.
Is it always like this, or was this close to Mardi Gras?
I was there over Mardi Gras. So okay. Before Mardi Gras, during, and then after.
And so do they have this market going on like all the time? I mean,
it was on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Oh, neat. So then you could work a couple days and restock to remake. I mean, how do you really keep up with this all?
I was, well, we made it. That was before, like I said, we prepared for this wholesale show, which wasn't very good. And then we did the show at the convention center, and that wasn't very good. It like kind of like bought us a little time, but we're like, mm-hmm, my friend Jason was with, mm-hmm, me, and we're like trying to wholesale there. We were just trying to see what we could do to make money, mm-hmm, and exploring the city. And that's when we found the market. And then we needed to set up at the Sherwood Forest Fair, which is in Austin, Texas. Mm-hmm. So I was driving back and forth after a while. So I'd do New Orleans on the weekend and I'd drive to Texas and do that and then drive back. And it was a little crazy.
But sounds like it. But I mean, it sounds like a whole lot more fun than just driving back and forth around South Minneapolis. You know, I mean,
it was cool.
Yeah, no, I know you have a great studio in Northeast, but it's
getting better.
Yeah, and so this is more Renaissance fair.
Yeah, there was a time period where I was doing a lot of pictures and really being good with doing them, and I need to start doing it again.
Well, I know that when we were working, we tried, and I maybe got 6 customers in on, you know, a good day.
Yeah.
That, but you're so busy, you know.
Yeah. It's kind of like it has to be the job, you know.
Right. So it's like, that's exactly.
Where you guys are selling, then I can. Right. I can schmooze. I get to schmooze and restock.
Exactly.
I like that. But I like, I was going to say something about that. Pic Collage is a really cool app you can use to see how she's got her earring, but then I got
and so Pic Collage is the app that you're using for it. I use one called Layout.
Oh, okay. Does that work too?
Yeah, and so that's what I made these with. Was the Layout.
Yeah.
And so but it really, I think it's great because you see the outfit, you see them, the close up,
yeah,
and you see their beautiful, happy, smiling face, yeah, which is what's important. And then you tag them. So it shows up on their feed too, probably, right?
When I'm organized enough to do that. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't always.
Okay.
I, since Ryan died, I haven't done much social media at all. You probably noticed.
Well, maybe we can help you with that if we have, you know, more of us at the fair. But it's just, it really makes an impact, I think. And so this is her beautiful work. As you can see, they're all wearing her gorgeous, you know, this is one of the giant filigree styles that she makes with all the beautiful, and each one turns out different, and how the people want to style them. You know, you've got stuff for everybody.
Yeah. They've got that kind of elaborate thing. That's kind of a bunch of combination of things.
I was going to say, this really looks, layered upon layered.
Yeah.
And a lot of fun. Otherwise, you know, everybody needs their symbolism. So I just love, you know, all the different animals you make, all the different things. Yeah, I mean, it's just, I love this guy. I think he's adorable.
He would come every year to the Renaissance Fair, and he always had some crazy shirt on.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know what, I haven't seen him since before the pandemic. So okay. I don't know what happened to him, but he was so sweet. I'm glad I got that picture of him.
Yeah.
That year. He'd always buy a pin for his hat or something.
I think it's great. I mean, and that's the fact, you have something for everybody, you know, necklaces, earrings, pins. And they're all just so uniquely done. So if you look here, there's more fun. And all these little, you know, these little bales and these little necklaces, all these are custom done for each pendant and for each customer. And so that is one of the really unique things that you do. I don't know why that's not.
Yeah, hopefully. Up. I'm hoping that I'll be. Sometimes we run out of time, so I have like a bunch of unfinished jewelry. So rather than not sell, which isn't an option, I just put out the unfinished jewelry and be like, I can make it however you want it. So, But ideally, we have enough finished stuff that we don't have to be customizing as we go. But it is fun to do. When you don't have too many people and you're trying to really streamline the sales and make sure you make as much as you can.
Right.
You
know?
But it is fun to do the customizing thing.
And then on Sherwood,
those two ladies.
Those who are in Sherwood. And how long have you been doing the Sherwood Fair as well? Because this is the third Renaissance Fair in the year you do, right?
Yeah, I don't do it anymore. That one was in February.
Okay.
My tall niece, Jason, had a booth there.
Okay.
It just didn't work out, but it was fun. That was the same year as being in New Orleans.
Back and forth. And so this, it looks like St. Patrick's Day. St.
Patty's Day and New Orleans.
So then you just kept going from
back and forth.
Oh my gosh. So from Mardi Gras to St. Patty's. So yeah, you were there. Well, who'd want to spend the winter in Minnesota when you can spend the winter in New Orleans, right?
It was pretty brutal in Minnesota. I saw a lot of Minnesotans in New Orleans. Yeah, we'd high five.
No, I mean, why not? I think that would be great. So then do you rent an apartment while you're down there for so long? Or how do you live caravan? Or you...
I was mostly camping in my van.
Okay.
And, you know, you just sleep in the van and then go to the coffee shop and use a truck stop shower or whatever. So it's a little rustic. I did house sit for some friends I met down there for a while and hotels, you know, occasionally. On the less expensive evenings, you can do hotel. And then in Sherwood, I just slept in the van because it's the kind of ready campground kind of thing.
Right.
But yeah, so.
But when you're traveling all around, that's really the way to keep expenses down is to shop in your, or live in your caravan. And,
kind of a thing.
So you have to be adventuresome, obviously.
I did some urban, what do they call that? Urban camping. So I drive around, find a good place to park. And you learn a lot about a city driving around and finding a place to park at night that you feel safe in.
That's kind of what I mean because there are some places that clean the streets at night, so you're not allowed to park in certain places, but I would think there's some beautiful neighborhoods, so like
there's some cool spots at home.
And so I mean, this is Ohio, right?
The girl with the feather necklace is Minnesota.
This one's Minnesota. Yeah. It just didn't look like your Minnesota booth, so I wasn't sure.
I think it's older. See that display behind
the
pictures? That's got a picture of me making the stuff and then a bunch of pictures of
this
people.
Whole display back here.
And it's got keywords on there. And it was fun to make, but it was a really good marketing thing. It was like a poster of
all the
things that would be interesting about kind of a collage of the thing. And it was really good marketing that I need to scan that because I have it and reuse it.
But, we could make a new one. I mean, and try some more fun things. You've got, I mean, there's just so many amazing things you make and the type of people that, I mean, I remember these people from the last 3 years from the fair. Exactly.
This is Santa Claus, I think, is the clauses.
They are the clauses, yes. And they're such a charming couple. And they walk into the booth and this is just one of their joys of spots, to be in. And so it's really nice to see, and I just don't normally, how do you remember them all?
Oh, I don't.
Okay.
I don't. Sometimes people look familiar.
But I know, because like the couple in the middle, I've seen at the Renaissance a couple times.
Yeah, they're super sweet.
And
that other girl's from, with the spider, she's from New Orleans.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And so, because that's inside.
She's one of the street kids living down there.
Okay.
You know, they get all those train riding kids. They come to New Orleans for the winter. And they hang out on the sidewalk and play music with their dogs.
Exactly.
They all got like giant dogs with them.
Well, that's mostly for protection, I think, isn't it?
Yeah.
And companionship. If you're living on the street alone, I think I would want, I mean, you've got Jude the cat as your companion in the studio.
That's true.
Does she travel with you too?
Jude, no.
Gidget travels with you.
I don't know if you have any
pictures. I don't have any pictures of Gidget. You did not send me any. I know. Tell everybody who Gidget is.
Gidget is the ferret. She's my son's ferret. So now she's my ferret,
and she's a beautiful little soul. She's coming to Bobby Bead and visit, and has been very, very
she was
behaved.
At the Bloom Festival.
Was she at the Bloom? Okay.
She likes to travel.
And so this was the Renaissance during the pandemic drive-thru.
Yeah, the famous, I don't know if anybody went to the famous drive-thru Renaissance Festival.
But it really supported the artists. I thought that was nice.
It was cool. They didn't even charge us to be there, which was miraculous. Originally we were supposed to set up inside, and then people were just going to drive by and you'd have like a minute with them. And then they realized that wasn't really going to work. So we were out in the parking lot, about 20 of us, and kind of set up on either side, and people would drive by. And then after two weekends of them trying to stay in their cars and us running up to them with these like canvas little things for them to look at, they just started parking and getting out. And then it was a little more traditional, you know, people would park, get out, then they'd go eat their food that they just got loaded in their car, you know, and they'd shop that little outdoor strip. So.
Well, I'm glad they did something to keep trying to do, you know.
It was fun. It was like a Renaissance flea market.
Yeah.
Because we had the car right there.
No, I think that that's great. And I love that the people came out and supported, and really, you know, it's, and so... Yeah, here is you tying on one of the wonderful necklaces. I'm not sure where these pictures are.
I think that's New Orleans, and the other one is Minnesota Renaissance Fair. Yes. Wow, that's a great picture, huh? It's just, here's my screenshot.
Well, exactly. But that's a way to do it. You know, no matter how you do it, you got it on there. It's on Facebook. Everybody's tagged, yeah. You know, and so, but it's kind of funny that there's no wrong promotion, honestly, I don't think.
Yeah, it's better. Just like with display, I feel like it's better to just fake it and get it out there and not worry so much, you know. Just do it. It'll all work out somehow. And improve every time, you know.
Right. You learn lessons with each one. And I definitely, I'm not sure where this is at.
That's New Orleans also.
Okay.
There are all those. She was so adorable.
Oh, she is. And your necklace, I mean, and so this is a bee layered on top of a filigree.
Yeah.
And then it was a nice little bail. So all of the pendants all come adjustable. So that way it fits perfectly in your cleavage.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, this one's similar to the butterfly I'm wearing, where it's got two sides.
Yeah.
But those are pretty filigree butterflies. I love. So what is your favorite bug to make? I mean, you've got bugs, you've got all sorts of winged critters. Cicadas here seem to be really popular with people. Do you know why that is?
I don't know why it is. I mean, it's a symbol of rebirth, or not rebirth, like I guess it is sort of rebirth. It's some people have said like reincarnation. I don't know. It means something to a lot of people.
And
but I just like bugs. So there's a lot of cool vintage stampings of the bugs available.
And so which
and I'll modify them.
And so painting on the filigree here where it's so open versus torch painting on these solid shapes. Is it a much different technique to do, or in your design process of how you come up with, you know, because each color accent seems to be purposefully placed, obviously.
Yeah. You have to be, I mean, the filigree gets hot faster. It's thin.
Oh, okay.
You just have to have a gentler touch, I guess.
And so.
Adjust maybe the temperature of the flame a bit, but it's more timing feeling than,
oh okay,
you know, for me, than like I don't know what temperature anything is. It's just
just how it looks.
Practice, lots of practice.
Well, you make all these amazing things, and these are layered upon layered as well. And so I don't know,
on the left, those two dragonflies, so that's, I wanted to make just a monochromatic one with no color. So I did the black and copper one.
It's really pretty because there's a lot of dragonflies like that.
Liked the monochromatic, but I did a test. I just was curious with mm-hmm. people. So I think I did like a giveaway or something on Instagram. It was during the pandemic.
Uh-huh.
I was like trying different stuff to see if I could do something with it. People wanted that green one.
Well, it's beautiful, you know.
They chose the colors over the monochromatic, I like monochromatic.
Well, because there's a big one flying around my yard this morning that looked just like this, had the black spots and then the clear and then the black. And apparently the black parts there's different texture in their wings, and that's how it allows them to go backwards and forwards. It's almost like the little flappies. They can raise these little parts of it, and that's how they change direction. If they didn't have that in their wings, they couldn't go backwards and forwards and up and down. They could only go straight.
Like little flaps, huh?
Yeah, uh-huh. And so
dragonflies are awesome.
They are. The one on the right here is a damselfly.
And is it?
It is. Okay. I actually Googled it because at the fairs, people would ask, because I know you have many styles of these.
Yeah.
And so, but yes.
We call them all dragonflies.
I know. But this one here with the curved wing where it's open and rounded is actually a damselfly.
Okay.
And only crazy people in my, what do you call it? Groups or butterfly groups would care or no, exactly. So you do so many things that are meaningful to people. You have a whole symbols collection. What do you find the most that people really buy? What shapes, what symbols, what is, Do you find a more popular, most popular?
Dragonflies are really high up on the list, you know. I mean, it depends on where you are. I was just at a balloon festival, so we just sold all, like, a lot of balloons.
Right, obviously.
And then we wholesaled the rest, whatever was left. We sold them to another vendor, so that was pretty
That's a great awesome. Marketing technique.
It worked good. She was going to the one in New Mexico.
Okay.
In Nepal, that big.
The big one, mm-hmm. Yeah.
But you can sell, there's a lot of different art being sold at like the Balloon Festival. There's a ton of art that they sell at those things.
And, you know, I saw it on Facebook and you see the lights and the balloons and that's all you see. I don't ever see, hear about the vendors at those things on there when they're promoting it much. And so.
It's like rodeos. I've did rodeos for years. I didn't even know. And then somebody mentioned, but you don't go to the stock show? And I was like, what's that? But there's a ton of art that sells at those things. You know, the ranchers come in to the stock show with their wives and they're on vacation. They're spending money.
Right. And so that's a lot more fun, I think, than
meet a lot of interesting people.
Right. You know.
You can sell at gun shows sometimes. Back in the day, I don't know if they stick mostly with guns.
I have no idea.
It's not my favorite thing, but I have them. Mm-hmm.
And so do you always make earrings and pendants like that would match when you're painting and your colorings, or do you?
The colors, that's the color palette you have. So I don't have to make them together.
Okay.
You know, you can find matching ones by looking through it. So I may have done those together because I was trying to advertise something, and make it look extra cool. So that was my Valentine's. That was the year that Ryden died right before. So like I didn't really do much with that, but it was a cool. Thought it was a good picture.
I think it's a great ad. You know, I mean, simple. It sustains itself, and so that's how. But you make all kinds of different things from skulls to krakens. And I mean, at the Renaissance Fair, the kraken gets a lot of attention.
Yeah.
And
well, he's cool. I mean, what's not to like about him? Really?
I know.
That'll be cool, but I used to just, when I started, I just used copper enamel shapes, and I just had shapes, and that was all that was, I knew about, you know, and then every year you get requests from people, or you see different things, and you try it, and then.
Well, the meaningful symbols are very popular too. Yeah. I mean, the peace signs are super popular, and you made a whole bunch of peace sign ornaments.
Yes.
You did well at the market, winter market.
They sent me the long peace signs. So instead of being this big, they were like this big. So I was like, well, we're making ornaments.
Right. And the crosses, the fleur-de-lis. And so these are a lot of the other shapes. Is that what you were initially, the fun curves and
like this kind of stuff where it's like a copper enamel shape? See, that was on my online show. That was one of the things.
And this is how you did them. You put them on the egg
and then they could bid.
Yep, F6. Yep.
So, but it did not work out. I had like different styles. I had this kind of like really kind of weird stuff. And then I had like leaves and some dragonflies and different things.
Well, I really like your fun shapes. Well, I don't know. It's interesting how you never know what is going to strike people. I know the hummingbird is a real popular. Everybody loves that. Maybe because it's on the front of your Etsy shop too.
Maybe. Yeah. And hummingbird. People just like hummingbirds. It's
hummingbirds.
Like cats. There's cat people. There's hummingbird people. So it seems like if you make something that is a hummingbird, then you've already are ahead of the game for advertising,
right?
Or for just grabbing somebody's interest rather than just a shape. But that's, you know.
And so you do pins, you do necklaces. What do you like to do best, or what sells best, do you think, at markets?
It depends, but
there's just rhyme or reason of.
I don't really know, you know, like some days you sell more necklaces, some days you sell more.
I just wasn't sure if like
earrings or necklaces
over pins.
People really like rings though as well, you know, but I don't sell a lot of those like with this style. Well, I was going to try and bring back the ring though.
And so I was going to say, rings are harder to make. All the different sizes is more important. Yeah. They're harder to deal with.
if I get to that again.
But. How did you do this one here? Is that layered upon layer
two? Yeah, that's just a vintage filigree shape that looks like it's uncolored, because it's nice to have that kind of neutral backdrop, and then the honeybee, which I did color with the torch work.
I love the cute kitties. I have a kitty pen.
People love the kitties.
How could you not? And the hoops are so popular.
Yeah.
They really are fun. And you have them in many different sizes, don't you?
A couple, there's like two sizes of that.
Or else you're
just depends on where you get your shapes from and stuff.
And so these are vintage die cut shapes. Is that what these ones are?
But they don't look like that one. The owl's pretty similar. I make them a little poofier. The hummingbird is flat and has feet, which is really weird. So so I like modify.
It's never land.
Or if they do, you don't see their feet when they're flying.
Right.
So I took those off, you know. I try to do things so even if I'm buying a shape that other people would have, it's going to look different.
And so then you hammered it and puffed him out, or you punch holes, or do you drill the holes?
Drill the holes.
I
could see the owl was crooked too. I did not do that. Oh, I did not drill that hole.
Well, he's looking to the side. He's not straight. He's giving you.
That was on purpose.
I was going to say, exactly, because you can see more. I mean, he's giving you the evil eye, and then he's going to go
Yeah.
Swoop down and you know, have some lunch. And so you've got animals as well as all the little winged creatures. Yeah. And I just think they're so cute. So then you make all these little bales and everything. Yeah. Or do your assistants pre-make them for you?
Nowadays, it's mostly Tamara that's been making a lot of them. And Kenzie does all the Etsy. Mm-hmm. Kenzie wires all the Etsy stuff up and packages it.
Nice. And so, because I know we make some of them at the Ren Fair, but, you know, it's just so busy that.
I'm hoping to have more done because it's too hard on the wrists. I can't do it anymore as much. I can still do it, but it's a lot to do.
But that's the neat thing that, I mean, every one of these is different. So when you look at a piece of copper, do you have a pattern in mind before you start or do you just start playing?
I can do like the ones that are on Etsy. I can duplicate pretty close. They're not all the same, but you know, like the horse, I like the kind of windswept look. But I have done some pintos and Appaloosas and different things where I'd like try different things. Mm-hmm. And that makes it kind of fun too. So,
yeah, because the kitty that I have looks more like my kitty because it was a, with all the crazy lines. And so how many different colors can you get out of copper coloring?
It's the full spectrum of color, basically. It's just kind of earth tones. So it's done with heat and it's basically natural, like a rainbow. So it has that full spectrum.
That is just so cool.
It's an earthy rainbow.
It is an earthy rainbow. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, and so, I mean, cause you're getting really bright, vibrant colors. Mixed with those earthies and it just pops. I mean, she's got earrings. So this is the feather in two different ways.
Yeah, that's the flame colored feather. And then we had, sometimes I like to do it. I don't have a lot of patience with it, but oxidize it, makes it that turquoise green color.
Oh, okay. So I was wondering.
People really like that stuff.
Well, turquoise has got to be one of the most popular blues, you know, and it goes so well with copper. It really blends.
Yeah.
And but that's an oxidation. And then you protect it as well. So then that doesn't change just like the flame coating.
Yeah.
And so giant wings and feathers. You've got like five different styles of these. Don't you like little mini for earrings? I got
mini feathers,
big ones.
On Etsy are different than that style there, but
and of course the wings. These are just so beautiful.
And those are vintage wings.
They are. Do you poof them up or they come that way? Because they're nice domed.
Yeah.
And so I think they're so pretty. The leaves seem really popular too, and the flowers.
And like the leaves come flat.
Okay. And so you do all that neat shaping.
Hammer it, put the veins in it, then color it.
And so the hammering all has to be done before the coloring. Yeah. Otherwise you'll ruin or change the colors. Yeah. Wow. And so... do you have a favorite shape that you like to do?
Coloring,
do you like the filigree? Do you like the leaves, the feathers? I mean, do you have a favorite?
I like coloring the big smooth things, you know, because you can play with the colors a little bit more, the pattern, but you can do that with all of them, you know. We've got...
And so when people are shopping, you've got some more that are like kind of layered upon layer here.
These are,
is this a custom design?
Well, they're ones that I have some customers that just like to put together their own things. Mm-hmm. So when I'd have like these boxes of unfinished stuff, then they'd come in and pick out their stuff and then we'd attach it together for them. So it's kind of, we kind of work.
We had a few of those last year at Adam Fair, and it would, you could see the creative process. It was almost like, you know, here shopping at the store, you know, but then of course you have to put them together. Yeah. You also are doing some other fun, different kind of designs too.
Oh yeah. These are because we were going to have two booths in Ohio, the gazebo and the cart. We wanted to have some different products. So.
Also, then you put different, completely different products?
Not completely different. It's along those lines, but I was trying to have like some fancier things. So like the scarab beetle, I combined with, I think that's African jade, like an African jade disc or whatever. And I said the wire wrap around with it. And then the same thing with the hair stick with the wire wrap and on the candle holder thing.
Well, I would think
experimenting with some different things.
Well, yeah. I mean, everybody does their hair up at the Renaissance Fair so nicely. I would think the hair sticks would really accent well.
And I like wire wrapping. Like, it's fun to do around anything. You can do it around your copper piece or your whatever, you know. Like that tree thing she's got over there is really cool.
Right. You know, I mean, it's, and
that,
yeah, it's that ginkgo tree, that Svetlana's
tree is awesome here.
Yeah, it is. It's so cool. So, and then these are some other really fun things.
Yeah, the triangles, that was somebody who was in AA and she wanted triangle for AA and NA. So she had
So this is not a texture, this is a pattern that you did in the copper. Wow, that's really cool. And then what are all these fun things?
Those were just
they kind of look like more layered upon and it had stone.
It was like, how elaborate can we get something? And then how much can we charge for it when it's, you know, at that elaborateness. So it was fun. And some of those were kind of Chong inspired as well. I'm trying to give them a little bit of ideas.
Because
you get stuck into like a little rut.
You know, because the skulls here are really fancy and crazy.
Sugar skull.
I never saw those before.
He used to come to the show with me every year.
I love it.
I should make some. I have several skulls from Michael's, you know.
Right, because these are just your, this is filigree. This is a heart upside down for the nose.
Yeah.
These are leaves.
Yeah.
And then this is a dragonfly for the forehead. I mean, that's just really cool.
Yeah, and it could get even more elaborate. So it was like kind of just doing something different because it gets really boring sometimes.
But I mean, I think these are fun ways to picture all your different, this is just another little marketing pictures you guys took.
Yeah.
But these leaves, is this a single leaf or is this a one
pile? Those are the bottom of feathers, and that was, Tom had me bring some stuff home for him, and then he cut it up into all these crazy things.
Oh my gosh.
And then, you know, it was like, oh, this is really fun, you know, like, look at this pattern, and we just had fun putting pieces together in all these different ways. And then we did some different colors. So those are oxidized.
Okay, that's what I was wondering. There's
no coloring in that. That's all these different oxidizations you can get with the copper.
Wow. I didn't realize you could get that many different colors with the oxidizing it.
Yeah, there's a lot of different. There's the verdigris, which is green, and then the, you know, like gun blue or the oxidized, the black, patina. And one's natural, and then there's a red.
And your favorite protectant to spray on them, to seal them, is it just like Krylon or what you seal them with something, right? Yeah. So they stay forever.
I use that, what is it, double 2X spray lacquer stuff. I haven't found one that I really like, though. Like they all don't last forever, you know.
Right,
like a urethane and that, you know, like they pour on things, that would probably be the best, but I don't know how to do that. I haven't figured it out. Yeah.
Right. Because a lot of people, I've seen those, but they get thick and gloppy too.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. And
so it's a, I'm still working on that.
It's a fine art form. How many years have you been working with copper? Like forever and ever, 30 some years. Yeah. And so you're still learning. So I don't feel so bad if I'm just starting out playing with something.
Because it's deep colored. So then, you know, I can't heat it up to attach like a, what would that be, an enamel or something.
Right.
You know, so it can't have that.
But interesting.
But I do guarantee stuff. So people can bring things back and I'll repair it for them.
Well, and that's a really, most companies wouldn't do that. And so I think that's a really nice thing. And they know how to find you through your Etsy shop.
Yeah.
Or I have seen people come back to the Renaissance Fair, but never had a repair. You know, they just like, oh, look at what I got last year. Look at what I got last year. And so, and I don't know why you were underwater, but I thought it
I didn't even know that picture was in there. I think that was just like, you know, when I was clicking.
You were clicking, because there was another one. It might be at the...
I got a cool necklace on, so...
And that's what I was going to say. You've got a great scarab on, and so I thought that was...
Like the aquarium.
It looks like the Mall of America Aquarium. Yeah. And there was another one where I saw a little girl in pink running through the tube. So I had to put your photo on here. And then this is you guys actually working with the torches here.
Yeah. That's right. And myself in the back there. That's easy using the big torch. And I have the little torch. It's like a little jeweler's torch.
Okay. And then you can change the, whether it's wide or narrow or lots of heat or little heat.
Yeah.
Or...
yeah, I can build a lot of things about that.
So, well, what kind of advice would you give to people who want to get out there into the flea markets and the other markets of how to, like how to get started? You just find, you know, what would be the best market for them? And you know, like, how do you get out there? You just search through internet who's having fairs or
I mean, you can go online and search for art fairs, and probably one of those ones that you pay a subscription to. I can't think of the names of any of them, of course, because my brain. But you can use any of those and research your town by town, town festivals, conventions, events, you know, any kind of event that's going to have people selling at, or many. I mean, we've been to like dragon boat races and so on stuff.
Wow.
So, you know, like anything really might have vendors at it. And if you wanted to make something that was themed towards that event, then, you know, like when we go to the horse fair, we feature horses. So. So that's or here is it. Sorry,
there you go.
I don't want to be boring or anything.
No,
I don't know. Can you see that?
It's beautiful. Well, here, let me stop sharing and then we'll that way. Then we can, then you can see better. A bigger you
there,
because that one's really unique.
So sometimes I'll do like,
there you go.
Okay.
Yep.
See the etching on there.
Yeah, that's really
cool. So I can do the etching, you know, like that's the phoenix. My niece went to a Harry Potter festival. Mm-hmm. So we did a bunch of Harry Potter fan art. So I had hedgehogs and I don't know, all these things. I don't know what the names of them are because I'm not a Harry Potter fiend, but she told me what to make. So then she was like, make a snake for the Slytherin or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So then I did some etching like that. So you can hone in, because on the internet, the more you can keyword things, the better.
Yeah.
Instead of just a shape, if it's a, I don't know, whatever shape.
Well, we are really, there's just so many things. Your Etsy shop is, we just had a photo of that, is Phoenix Fire Designs, right?
Phoenix Fire Jewelry, but it's Jewelry.
jewelry.
It is. It's weird. I can send you the.
Wait, I just link. Had it here.
If you have,
put it back on. It's yeah, jewellery.
Yeah,
jewelry.
Because there were too many. There was no Phoenix Fire jewelry was already taken.
Okay.
So Tong made the initial Etsy play, like put all his stuff up, and so he did that. But that's okay. It works.
It does. I mean.
And then I, you know, did the pictures and stuff. So.
And so it is. And so, where besides the Minnesota Renaissance Fair, where are you going to be next weekend?
Next weekend, Tamara's going to be in Upper Wisconsin doing just a little town fair. And then she'll go to Ely, Minnesota for the Blueberry Festival. I think it's a blueberry festival in Wisconsin too. So two blueberry festivals and then Grand Marais, and then every week is the flea market. So we'll mix that all up. And then she's doing a fair that I did last year in the UP, which is Copper Harbor, you know, like up in that area.
Well, and copper is found in Michigan. Yeah. So they might have a more love for that there, right?
Yeah. And it's, you know, tourists, you just want to be where there's tourists.
And so that's the idea, is go wherever there's tourism.
Yeah.
And you're sure to sell stuff. Oh my God.
A lot more sure than.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah. So.
Well, that sounds like a lot more fun than just standing around waiting for somebody to walk in your shop.
Well, yeah.
I mean, really, guys. So, I mean, think about it. You know, what would you rather do? Go to a show at Bead Fest, go to a show at the Renaissance Fair, or New Orleans Market?
Well, like, you know, it's always a business expense too.
Oh, right. You know. And so then you can write off your travel, your stay, your everything.
Yeah, because you're really using it for business.
You are. Oh, I never thought about that. What a great way to like
live your life.
Live your life and a lot more fun. Oh my gosh. So. See the world, experience it, meet new people from everywhere.
Yeah.
So you just have to be willing to drive, travel, and
yeah, which I like to do. So I always have. So
right.
It's not
so the setting up and setting down is not a real deterrent.
No, because I'm kind of lazy these days. You know, if I go to a show alone, I'm usually just doing a flea market or it's a simple display. You know, but they have easy tents and things that are literally you can push it up with one hand almost.
Right.
Or I like the market umbrellas is a nice lightweight alternative too.
And so how do you keep the wind from blowing everything away?
Well, at the flea market, I use my car as a weight.
Oh, there you go.
Then, you know, even like Tamara and I at the Bloom Fest, we could park right behind it. So we tied the tent right to the car.
Okay.
And then you don't have to worry about the wind flipping your tent and all that stuff. Because we've been there and done that a few times. Where your tent is all destroyed.
Right. And so
weather is a factor of selling outdoors.
And but a lot, like at the Ren Fair, when it rained, everybody rushed into the booth.
Yeah.
And then we sold all kinds of stuff. And so when you're just at the flea market, do you have to cover everything then and then uncover it?
Well, that's where the tent thing or some kind of shelter becomes good, you know. So I have sold in the pouring rain in any easy up before, you know, and as long as you feel safe to them, you know. So, but I've had a couple times where I've been in a pretty scary storm, you know, and you're hanging on to your tent.
Oh my gosh.
And maybe if you're lucky, there's some other people in there with you, like other customers, you know, and you're all just grabbing aside. And,
right.
You know, I think me and Tamara and three other people rode out this, those straight line winds that went through and they knocked mm-hmm. down the boundary waters
yeah.
back in the day. That went through south. We were in North Dakota. Went through North
Dakota. My husband was in the boundary waters during that storm.
Oh, shit. Oh.
Yeah. Oh. It was really bad. They had to,
scary.
They had to really go ways away to get out because of, you know, it was too hazardous.
So
to
we go. Were in an easy up.
You were in an easy up during that. Wow. Oh, my God.
It was scary.
Absolutely. Well, but I think that's, you know, a little small price to pay for all the other fun and excitement and yeah, great sunny days. Exactly. Yeah. You know,
so
that sounds like a lot
more like fun. If you like that sort of thing.
So I guess maybe it's not for everyone, but for a lot of folks, I think it's a lot more fun way of doing business.
Yeah.
You know, and then having the Etsy so that everybody can just, you hand them the thing,
yeah,
Etsy information, and they can always find you later.
Mm-hmm.
Or you bought one piece and you're like, okay, I need to get one for someone else.
Yeah.
And so.
I like the in-person marketing, you know.
It's more personal. I mean, people yeah. really are like, I remember when I got that. I was here. Mm-hmm. So there's not just a memory of the cool jewelry. There's a memory of the experience.
Yeah.
And so yeah. I think that really, you know.
That makes it really fun.
It does. How do you keep, though, all the costs? Because your stuff is very reasonably priced. I mean... I obviously that's the market, you know. I think when you're in more farmers markets or street fairs, you can't sell a $5,000 piece of art as easily as you yeah. can sell 50 necklaces.
Yeah.
You know.
I used to sell some bronze sculptures that I did just mostly for fun, but I
right.
put one on the table.
Yeah.
I just had one. I put it
well, on the there. One in your booth at the Renaissance Fair, everybody asks about that one.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
You know,
yeah.
And are like, oh man, did, you know.
Yeah. So when they had enough of them, you know, if you have a few, they have a choice. But I've sold a few
mm-hmm.
there, you know, for like,
yeah.
like, wow, that was $2,000. Cool, you know.
Well, but I would expect it at the Ren Fairs, you know, to have all levels of art.
Yeah, but not just at Ren Fairs.
But you
it's
know,
it's amazing so. What you can put out, and you never know who's gonna
mm-hmm.
who's gonna come to that. It could be somebody who has the money and like some cool piece mm-hmm. of art. So if you have your whatever simple beaded earrings or things that are your bread and butter, but then you also have your super fancy thing that mm-hmm. you take to the fairs to show people or whatever.
Well, because that wow factor yeah. really helps draw them in yeah. and also give like, well, there's a lot of detail.
Yeah, they respect you more.
I think so too. Yeah. So that makes a lot of sense.
And they see that higher price tag on there, and then they're, if you see a high dollar price and then you look down at something that's $20 or whatever, that seems really reasonable all of a sudden. And they're like, oh,
okay. Yeah. That's a really interesting marketing strategy. Yeah. Yeah.
So that's a good way to show the value of your creations.
Mm-hmm. So. I don't know. Any other questions, advice? People are saying thank you for sharing your imaginative and beautiful pieces. They're very unique.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah. You know, and but we are, if anybody had any questions for Pam, you are more than welcome to ask.
Yeah, I'll try to make something up.
But
so, Rochelle, I was just wondering what, Pam, you're at the Minneapolis Farmers Market, right?
I have been, yeah.
Right. And are you doing that still this summer?
I'm not doing it this summer. My niece did it once this year.
Okay. Okay.
I probably won't, just because, like I said, I'm too lazy.
You're doing the regular Monday market in Wisconsin.
Yeah, your, either your I summer. Or Tamara does it. My niece, my niece started working with me full time. So she helped me get my paperwork in order. Then she helped me. And she does shows, you know, to kind of, mm-hmm. we just are sort of smerging. Since my son died, this is the other family member that I would pass my thing on to, you know.
Well, it's nice that you can work with the family and yeah. keep, you know, and your nieces are really charming.
So there's this, my niece, and then actually Kenzie.
Oh, yeah.
Who was my son's girlfriend or fiance or whatever at one point in life, but she's working out there.
I was going to say, she's kind of your adopted member of the family.
So. It's fun to work with family to a certain degree, you know,
uh-huh.
and spend time with people in your life.
Yeah, makes sense. Makes sense to me.
Yeah.
So. Wow, it sounds like a lot of work, but yet a lot of fun.
Yeah.
You know.
I don't know if I went off on a total tangent. I answered the question.
I think you did. Well, I think they're trying to find more of you to see if you're doing any local fairs here besides the Renaissance Fair. Some of our members can't make it to the Renaissance Fair because of mobility issues.
Yeah.
So if they were anywhere around here.
I did Art of World this last year in Northeast with Anna from Levine Leather.
Okay.
Renaissance Fair.
And that's in
and that was at the Casket Arts building. So if there's a Christmas thing, I might do it there. Otherwise I'll be at the European Christmas Market in St. Paul at the Depot.
At the Depot. She'll be at the Christmas market again. That happens from Thanksgiving through up to Christmas. And that's at the Depot.
And the Renaissance Fair, because then I go down to Ohio for a little bit. Ellen Peggy's Holiday Boutique.
I was going to say, I showed that. And so yeah. Peggy's Holiday Boutique, you've done for multiple years.
But if anybody wanted to do stuff like beadwork stuff, just you could reach out through even Etsy, or probably Etsy people mentioned me on Etsy a lot. But then, you know, to get pieces that aren't finished or whatever, just like the raw pieces.
Oh, okay.
That they can add beads to, because I know I've sold stuff like that to beaders.
Right, because I know I use your little pieces on the end. Yeah.
I really like labradorite. I don't know how you say it, but you know the gray one that's shimmery.
Yeah.
The red tiger's eye, especially with the copper. But, you know, and then there's like all the beads, the toho beads, like all those colors.
Mm-hmm. They go really well. Absolutely. And so yeah, there's a lot of places here that you can find her.
Or reach out to me on Etsy. And my studio's in Northeast Minneapolis, so I can, you know, be open there if I want to mm-hmm. meet somebody, you know, to look at stuff. By appointment or whatever.
Yep. Sounds good.
Or I guess you could reach out to Rochelle. You could do it to Bobby.
Whatever. Yeah. And so you can see it all if you want to. We will post more about where she's going to be as well. I'll post it on our the Upper Midwest Bead Society Facebook page, and I'll share more. So then when I see her flyers come up, I'll reshare them to y'all. That way you can come and see and get some copper magic. It's beautiful. But try out, you know, and take your wares to an art fair. Take your wares to a flea market and try something different.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to go for the Uptown Art Fair or the Edina Art Fair, you know, try something that's more fun. I mean, they are big, but aren't they a lot more expensive to just do just because the booths are more expensive?
You know, I mean, it is fun to be at those kind of things where everybody's like, ooh,
yeah,
art, you know,
right.
You know, and it's all about art.
Yeah.
It's just really hard to get into those shows. And it is expensive.
I think the Uptown Archer, I don't know, it used to be $500, probably more than that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, maybe not, because Uptown is kind of,
oh, right, yeah.
Not the same place it was.
But I would think that, so even though you might have bad weather, it's worth it, right?
I think so. You know, just pack efficiently.
Plan for every.
Yeah. So if you have to pack up fast, you can just get the heck out of there.
There you go. And then have everything organized in trays or on pallets or something that's easily to that go in and out. That makes sense. That's good, helpful tips.
Well, thanks. My first show, I got so sunburned and the wind blew all my stuff around everywhere. So
then you got a bigger umbrella and you weighted it down.
Yeah, you know, I just didn't think about it. That was a long time ago.
That's a learning curve, that's for sure. Oh my gosh.
That's like in my 20s.
Okay, well, that was a wild time. You're a pro now. Oh my gosh, you're a pro. Well, thank you so much for joining us. And I hope that people will take to heart living an alternative lifestyle that's a whole lot more fun, you know, sounds like. Than, I don't know. Your motto is what? Life's too short to wear boring jewelry?
Yeah, that was, I don't know where it came from. I think it was completely fun.
Okay.
Or one of his friends or something. But I was like, yeah, that's a cool.
Yeah, it is. So surround yourself with good friends and workmates and just have fun with it.
Yeah. Have art parties.
Have art parties. I like that.
Yeah.
We'll have to go with that.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you so much. I think that, you know, hopefully this is some inspiration for you all. And to find more of Pam, Phoenix Fire Jewelry.
Yeah, can you put the link up there?
I'm
trying
to find it. Yep. I'm gonna put the link up here. I've got the Etsy shop, and we'll put the link in the Facebook post as well, so that everybody can find it. Yeah. All righty. Well, thank you so much. We are really hoping that you all have a wonderful night, and thanks for joining us. Happy beating. Happy, you know, I'm going to stop recording now. There we go. Yes.